Welcome to Live with Passion. I'm Father Cedric Bazania. I'm so glad that you tuned into the program. I want you to know that you can hear God's voice. And I pray that this program will be a way that God's voice is mediated to you. Listen to the scripture, John chapter 10. Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life. They shall never perish, and no one shall snatch them out of my hand." The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. So we're used to so many voices in our life. There's the voice of TV, the voice of radio, voice of people, voices all around us. And we have to try to discern how God's voice is coming to us. And I want you to know that you can hear from God, and God does speak. We just have to be able to listen. You know, there's a show on television called The Voice. It's on NBC. It's a singing competition. They're trying to identify the best singers in the world. And I remember I was watching it one time a couple years ago, and a singer from Houston, Danielle Bradbury, was on the competition. Her voice was so angelic and so easy to listen to. Now, the voice of God is easy to listen to also, but it's not as easy to hear as turning on a voice competition on TV. Oftentimes what we have to do is discern the voice coming to us, because it comes to us in so many different ways. And I love what the gospel reading said, that Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice." It's interesting, at the time of Jesus, shepherds, in order to protect their sheep at night, they would put the sheep into a common enclosure. So there would be a couple different flocks, maybe two or three different flocks together in a common enclosure at night, and the shepherds would be there. Then in the morning, to separate the sheep, the shepherd would simply call the sheep, and the sheep would identify the shepherd by his voice. And they even say that other shepherds would try to imitate one of the shepherd's voices, and the sheep would not go for that deception. They were able to have voice recognition of the shepherd by his voice. And I believe that you can have voice recognition in your life, that you can hear the voice of your shepherd. And although other shepherds, quote shepherds, other voices come to you, you can discern the true voice of God in your life. And I want to try to help you to do this in this program. I remember one time I was preaching in Naples, Florida, just recently, and I was driving down the Naples. If you know anything about Florida, Naples is way on the west coast, all the way down, and I was driving all the way from Houston. So I spent the night in Ocala, Florida, and while I was in Ocala, I went into one of these Cracker Barrel restaurants just to have a little bit of lunch. I think it was dinner, actually. And as I was there, I was looking in their shop that they have there, and I asked one of the people who worked there, I said, "Do you have any chocolate there? I just wanted a little dessert." And then I went to pay for the chocolate that I bought. It was a little candy bar. And the man at the desk said, "Are you on television?" And I said, "Well, yes, I am." He goes, "I recognized your voice when you were talking to that woman." And I said, "Well, that's interesting. People can hear my voice and recognize it. That's voice recognition." And I'm praying that through this program, you won't just hear my voice, but you'll be able to hear the voice of God. Because God's voice comes to us through television, through radio, through books, through music, through poetry, through scripture, through conscience, through the Bible, in so many different ways. And I really believe that you can hear from God. It is possible to hear God's voice. If you remember in the movies years ago, the voice of God was always depicted as being thunderous. You know, this probably comes from the scriptures. One of the scriptures says, "The Lord's voice flashes flames of fire." And they would always have somebody like James Earl Jones in a very stern, kind of a harsh voice saying, I am God, obey me, you know, that kind of a thing. Well, that is not the way that I've encountered God. In fact, whenever I talk about God's voice, I always try to be gentle. I always try to be calm. I always try to be peaceful, because I have encountered God's voice as very soothing, as very peaceful, and as very gentle. In fact, you'll notice at the end of my programs, when we have the opportunity to buy resources or become a partner with my program, I always have a female voice. And the reason I do that is because I want people to know that my programs are to create an ambiance of peace. And that's the way God is. God is very peaceful. God is very gentle. If you remember in the scriptures, when it came to hearing God's voice, there were numerous examples of hearing God's voice, right from the book of Genesis in the beginning, Adam and Eve in the garden, all the way to the end of Revelation, where God says, "Behold, I make all things new." God is always speaking. Well, in the scriptures, there's one important story that I've shared in other programs, other episodes, that I just want to share right here, because I think it's so powerful and it relates to my life. And that's the story of Elijah the prophet, up on Mount Carmel. And he goes to a cave, and all of a sudden there was a tremendous earthquake. And it said that the scripture said that the Lord was not in the earthquake. Then there was a ferocious fire, and the scripture said that the Lord was not in the fire. Then there was a howling wind, and the Bible says the Lord was not in the wind. And then after the earthquake, in the fire, in the wind, there was a still small voice, a tiny whisper, and Elijah knew it was God. Can you hear the tiny whisper of God? The still small voice. That's why I think it is so important when you pray just to spend a little bit of time in quiet. You may not hear anything right at that moment, but what it does is it makes you susceptible. And this is the power of contemplative prayer, centering prayer. You spend time in quiet, and you may not hear anything right at that very moment, as I said. You may even be distracted. But later on, it makes you susceptible to discerning the voice of God that comes to you. Because most of the time, it's not in the earthquake and the wind and the fire. It's in a gentle, still, small voice. And we have to be susceptible and open to hearing it. And it can come to you. I remember the story about Thomas Merton, the monk. He was a Trappist monk, lived at Gethsemane Abbey in Kentucky. And one day he was out in Louisville, Kentucky, just walking on a street. And he came to the street corner of 4th and Walnut. It's a very famous story. And while he was just standing on the street corner, people were passing by 4th and Walnut. All of a sudden, he had this, he called it an epiphany, a manifestation of grace, where he had this inner knowing about the love of God for himself and for people. And as he said, "I suddenly realized that I loved all people." He didn't hear a voice per se, but it was an inner knowing. It was a manifestation. You have to understand, Thomas Merton spent hours and hours and days and weeks and months and years in that Trappist Abbey in silence, in solitude, in contemplative prayer. And what that did is it opened him up so that even in the midst of a crowd, he could hear the voice of God. As I said, throughout the scriptures, people have heard the voice of God. I think about the call of Samuel, for an example. Samuel was a young boy, and he heard his name as he was going off to sleep. You know, "Samuel, Samuel." And by the way, God does speak, and he calls you by name. In other words, he speaks to you personally, heart to heart. He's the one that gave you life. Every heartbeat, every breath, every moment is from him, and he knows your name. So he called Samuel, Samuel. Samuel, the Bible said, was not familiar with the Lord at that time. In other words, he didn't have a personal relationship with God. He had not heard God's voice. So he went to Eli and he said, "Eli, you called me." And Eli said, "Go back to bed." He went back to bed and God called again. And that's what God will do. He will call you over and over and over and over again until you get it. Three times he called Samuel. Samuel didn't get it. He kept going to Eli. Finally, Eli said, "Look, I think that's God calling you." And if he calls you again, say, "Speak, Lord, your servant listens." And sure enough, God called again. It was Samuel's call to be a prophet. Perhaps there are some of you being called to be priests, brothers, sisters, lay leaders, called into ministry. And God has spoken to you, and he's called you before. And like Samuel, he's called you over and over and over again. Well, he's calling you again through this program. And I pray that you will have the posture, instead of not thinking it's God or not believing, that you'll have the posture of saying, "Speak, Lord, your servant listens." God is calling you. God is speaking to you. And of course, Samuel became a great prophet. It is one of my hopes that God will use these programs to call young men and women, older men and women, to ministry as lay leaders, as priests, sisters, as brothers, whatever God calls you to. Speak, Lord, your servant listens, because God is calling today. He needs prophets. He needs priests. He needs kings to serve the King of Kings. Would you say yes to God today? And I'm praying that he's going to use this program to call you. Augustine one time was out in a courtyard, St. Augustine. He wasn't so saintly back then. But Augustine was in a courtyard. All of a sudden, he heard this voice, and it said, "Take up and read." And he thought for a moment, then he understood that the voice had to do with the Bible. And as he began to read the scriptures, as he began to read the Bible, he had a conversion. And that's interesting, God's voice calling him to the scriptures. Because it's in the scriptures, oftentimes, that God reveals his voice. And then I think about my own life. I was a young man, 18 years old, going to college, freshman in college, just graduated actually from my freshman year. And the first time I ever heard God's voice, actually, God had been speaking to me all my life. Just didn't know it. It was kind of like Samuel, you know, I'd hear the voice, I didn't know what it was. This inner knowing, this still small voice, this gentle, peaceful voice of God. Not a harsh voice, not a mean voice, but a loving voice, the one who created me. Easy to listen to, sometimes so easy that you miss it. Well, actually, the first time I ever heard God's voice, here's what it was. It was in my conscience. That's what the Catholic Catechism says, that in our conscience, get this, a person's conscience is our most secret core in our sanctuary. We are alone with God in our conscience, whose voice echoes in our depths. I love that. The voice of God echoes in the depths of our conscience. You know, when you hear your conscience, it's your voice, it's your self-talk. But who's initiating that voice? Is it you or is it God? Oftentimes it's you, but sometimes it's God. You've always heard, and I've heard it too, follow your conscience. Let your conscience be your guide. It will never lead you astray. And I think that's what hell is going to be. When you're in the darkness, your conscience will accuse you for not listening to it. You had the chance and you missed it. Well, you still have the chance. Let your conscience be your guide. It will either bring you glory or it will bring you shame. Well, the first time I think I really listened to the voice of God was when I was getting up. I was 19 years old, 18, 19, just after my freshman year, getting out of bed before all the other voices bombarded me. You know, the voice of TV, the voice of radio, the voice of commercials, the voice of friends. Just getting out of bed, it was very quiet. And as I'm getting up, just stretching a little bit, I heard, "You're not happy. You don't know what life is. You're missing something." Well, what was that? You know, it wasn't an audible voice. It was my conscience. It was just me. And then it happened kind of like Samuel, time and time and time again. And I finally did something about it. I didn't even think it was the voice of God. I thought it was just me. I began to go to the scriptures. And I remember I got the Bible. I said, you know, I'm not happy. I'm a college student, you know, living like a college student, but I'm really not happy inside. I'm missing something. I feel like I'm missing something, and I want to know what it is. And I remember the truth is supposed to be in the Bible, so I went to the scriptures. Second time I heard from God, the Bible. You know, one of the primary places you can hear the voice of God is through the scriptures. Scripture means sacred writings. Bible means books. In the books of the scriptures. So I remember, so here I am, you know, right after I had this voice from my conscience, and I come to the scripture, and I just went to Matthew 7:7. I'll never forget this. And it says, "Ask and you shall receive. Knock and the door will be opened. Seek and you will find." And I mean, it was my voice reading it, but wow, it was this inner knowing that that was for me. So I want to tell you that you can hear from God, your conscience, the Bible. I remember on my Facebook page, I have a Facebook page. Just go to my website, fathercedric.org, and you'll see there's Facebook, there's YouTube, there's Twitter, there's all these different things. Well, on my Facebook page, we have a community page there. I asked people, do you hear God's voice? And if so, how do you hear it? And people overwhelmingly said, yes, I can hear from God. And they listed all kinds of different things. The Bible, people, creation, prayer, your conscience, books, preaching, TV shows, movie, poetry. Does God speak? Yes. See, God is what's called incarnational. That means he became flesh. In other words, we are sensory people, so God speaks through our senses, not just our hearing, but visually. Taste and see the goodness of the Lord. The Lord touches us. Even the smell of incense can oftentimes bring a sense of the presence of God. So all the senses, God is incarnational. I mean, it's interesting, one time just recently I was having some trouble with my vocal cords. When I don't preach, when I take a little bit of a rest, the muscles in my vocal cords atrophy and I start to get laryngitis. I'm great when I'm on the road and I'm preaching, when I'm preaching for TV and everything, doing fine because I'm exercising. You know, the vocal cords are muscles and I'm exercising and they're doing great. Well, I would get like laryngitis, so I went to an ENT, an ear, nose, and throat specialist. And I went there and I said, I'm having trouble with my vocal cords. Could you help me with this? So he said, well, let's do a little test. So he put a tube down there and they showed it on the screen so I could see it too. I saw my own vocal cords. Never in all my life, and this just happened recently, you know, I've used my vocal cords all my life. I'm used to my voice. People are used to my voice, but I had never, ever seen them before. And we looked for nodules or anything that was wrong. He said, your vocal cords are healthy. They look great. You just get too rested sometimes. You need to keep exercising them. But just to see my vocal cords, you know, those vibrating muscles that emit the sound that you're hearing now was touching for me. God has vocal cords. And what are those vocal cords? Creation, people, the Bible, your conscience, music, good TV programs like this one hopefully is touching you, movies. It's amazing how God will use different things and people and all of our sensory experiences to touch us and to speak to us. Well, it's interesting, you know, we get all these different voices and we want to hear the voice of God. I remember I was looking at a newspaper one time, and the newspaper had something called a Find the Word puzzle. And if you've ever seen these Find the Word puzzles, they have all these letters everywhere. It's a big square puzzle. And, you know, all the letters from A to Z are all kind of jumbled up in there. And you got to find the word. The word can be horizontally, it can be vertically, it can be diagonally, but it's hard to find the word because there's all these other letters all around it. But once you see it, you go, how could I have missed it? It was right there. In the same way, I believe that that is the way it is with the voice of God. We live in the midst of all these different voices, and there's the voice of God right in the middle of it all. But because of all the other voices, it's all jumbled up. And in order to hear the voice of God, you've got to slow down a little bit and discern that voice. God does speak to you. God is there, and He wants you to hear His voice. Some of you are being called. Others of you, God simply wants to tell you that He loves you, that He's with you, and He wants to help you. So in the midst of all these different voices, how do you know God's voice? Here's a real clear-cut way. Here's a real simple way. I have discovered through the scriptures, through hearing the voice of God in my own life, whether it be my conscience or discerning God, the voice of God is always positive. And oftentimes the voices that we hear from the world, and especially the voice from evil, is always negative. Remember what I told you in that opening story. When they put all the sheep together, they can separate the sheep because the sheep will only listen to the shepherd's voice. It has voice recognition. And I want to help you to get better at your voice recognition, at discerning the voice of God in your life. And how do you do that? A real simple, clear-cut way, and this is always true. The voice of God will never be negative, will always be positive. The voice of evil will never be positive, it's always negative. And we all get these voices bombarding us, and especially the voice within. Psychologists call this self-talk. And oftentimes we'll hear things like, I can't do it, I'm not good enough, I'm never going to amount to anything, I'm not going to be able to realize my dreams. That isn't the voice of God. The voice of God will say things like, I am with you, I will help you, you are precious and I love you, take courage, peace be with you, I'm going to work through you. I am calling you. Sometimes, you know, you can hear the voice of God calling you, and you might be saying, that's just me. God can't possibly be calling me. I thought that way. You know, I had panic attacks. I'm afraid. You know, I'm not the best. There's so many other better speakers than I am. I was thinking, how could God be possibly calling me? Then, finally, when I discerned the voice of God, became a priest, was a priest preaching, and then I sensed that I'm hearing the voice of God calling me to more. I was reading the prophet Isaiah, chapter 49, and it said this, it's too small a thing for you to raise up the tribes of Israel, restore the tribes of Israel. I will make you a light to the nations. And I read that, and it hit me so hard. Again, the voice of God, it's not real loud, but it's this inner knowing. And it hit me so hard. I was already preaching to thousands of people, traveling all around the country. When I heard that, I knew what it meant. God was calling me to get on television, that His salvation, and that's exactly what I preach, being saved. Remember, you will hear the voice of God and have eternal life, Jesus said, so that His salvation could reach to the ends of the earth. And I thought, how am I ever going to do that? See, that's that negative voice. And I had to, in order to get on TV, to get the outlets, to get the money, and to continue on TV, you have to continue to listen to the positive voice of God in order to stay married, in order to raise children, in order to become a religious, to say yes to God in a vocation. You have to listen to the voice of God because there's so many conflicting voices coming against us. One of the places I love to go on retreat is Big Sur, California. And Big Sur is one of the most beautiful places in the world, and there's a monastery there where I love to pray. The Bible says in Psalm 19 that creation proclaims the handiwork of God. Their voice is spread throughout all the world, but their voice is not heard. In other words, God speaks in creation without saying a word. You can't hear it, and that's what I would do. I would look up at night at the stars. You can't hear the voice, but you can hear it. You see it, and it speaks. That's what artwork can do. It speaks. That's what Michelangelo said after one of his statues. He did Moses. He sculpted Moses. And then he looked at it, and he said, speak. And it does speak. God speaks through statues and artwork and music and poetry and creation, as I said. You can hear the voice of God. He's speaking to you. He's calling you by name. It's real simple. It's not complicated. It all has to do with being positive and not being negative. And as this program comes to a conclusion, I want to remind you, I'm all about helping you to live with passion. I want you to fulfill your destiny. I want you to become all that you can be. And I want you to live with a deep, intimate relationship with God. And here's how I want to conclude. I am praying that God is using this program to speak to you. Whatever you're going through in your life right now, you can do it. God is with you. He loves you, and He wants to help you. He's calling some of you. And I want you to know that you can hear the voice of God calling you to ministry, to reach out to others. And if today you hear the voice of the Lord, harden not your heart. Have the same posture as Samuel. Right now, say, "Speak, Lord. Your servant listens." Don't just live, live with passion. I hope you like my preaching about hearing the voice of God. Some of you are being called like Samuel, like I was, to become a priest, a brother, perhaps a sister. I hope you'll get a spiritual director to discern the voice of God. And also, I hope you'll call my number. They'll put you in touch with me, and I'll help you along the journey. Maybe some of you are being called to be a passionist. I am hoping that my program, Live with Passion, will help facilitate God's movement in your life, that you will hear the voice of God to become all that you can be. I'm trying to help you to live with passion. Also, I want you to know that you can hear from God through my resources. I got a letter from a man in prison named James, and he said, "I've read your book, You Can Change, Live Passionately, Glorious Holy Spirit. God's Not Boring. Your books have changed my life," he said. My resources will help you to hear from God, whether it be the DVDs or CDs, or one of my 19 books. I just wrote a book called Challenges Make Champions that I really like. If you buy all my books at one time, you'll get it at half price. All the royalties go toward the production and the airing of Live with Passion all around the world. Thank you, thank you, thank you in advance for purchasing my resources. And don't just live, live with passion.
Purpose, passion, impacting others. Jesus taught we can have purpose when we help others. If you want to have passion and be happy, reach out. Father Cedric's programs are touching people across the globe. People in prisons, hospitals, hotels, and homes are being impacted. Lives are being changed. Young and old are coming to Jesus Christ. You can reach out to others through these programs. Be a part of this vital ministry. Simply call 844-FATHER-C. That's 844-328-4372. Visit www.frcedric.org or write us. We will send you envelopes with no obligation. With your first donation, designate which book you would like for free. Thank you for helping Father Cedric make a difference everywhere.